I never intended to only be a historical novelist. I just like to tell stories. I like to write fiction. And it just happens that the stories that I came up with that worked as books were historical. For many years, when I was trying to get published, when I was in my 20s, I was writing books about people like me in their 20s who lived in cities, and books about the problems that 20-year-olds get in that seem very important when you're 20, things like that, romance and bad jobs and things like that. But no one was publishing them. And I finally got an agent who could help me get published. And I had written a book about a rock band, very, very contemporary and modern. And she tried to sell it to publishers, but they all said, no, thank you. We think he's a good writer, but we don't like the story. And it was very depressing for me because I felt like I came very close to getting published but failed. And she said, well, write another book. What are your other ideas? And I had several ideas, and most of them were similar to the rock and roll book, but one of them was The Last Town on Earth, this historical novel. And she said, you should write that. So I wrote that, and that's what got published. So I never expected that my first novel would be historical, but that was the one that worked and that succeeded. And you know, I think history is full of amazing stories and amazing people and, you know, terrible struggles and conflict and, you know, inspiring stories of how people overcame tough odds. So very often when I'm reading about history, when I'm reading about the past, when I'm reading about politics from an earlier era, I find a story that I think, wow, this is amazing. What if a character did this and then did this and went over here, and next thing I know it is a book. So The Last Town on Earth is about a fictional town, but I got the idea because I learned many years ago, in the late 90s, I was reading a magazine and it discussed the 1918 flu epidemic, which I had actually never heard of at that time. And I know I risk sounding stupid to say that now, because now we all know about the 1918 flu because so much has been written and talked about it because of our current pandemic. But in the late 90s, at least in America, in the States, it had faded from memory. When I would talk to friends and family about it, most people had never heard of it. Some people might have dimly remembered it, but it was this horrible historical moment that it's not taught in history classes in the States. I had majored in history, but I had never heard of it. So that was part of what interested me. But what really got my attention was this article mentioned that some towns that were not yet infected, because they were so terrified of the stories they heard about how contagious it was and how fatal it was, they decided the only way to protect themselves was if they blocked all the roads leading into town and posted armed guards to prevent anyone from coming in. And so when I read that, I was just blown away, as we say in the States. It didn't seem real. It seemed like a scene from a book or a movie, but no one had ever written it before. And I wanted to be that writer, because I thought it could be a very dramatic scene, a very suspenseful scene, if you and your friend are standing guard one day, and you don't really think anyone's going to come to your town, because your town is deep, deep in the woods of Washington State, in the foothills that lead to the North Cascade Mountains. You think it's just a formality that you're standing there, but one day, a stranger appears. He's cold, he's lost, he's hungry, but he's also coughing and sneezing. You know, what do you do? What's the right thing? I don't know. I understand both perspectives. One of them thinks we need to do the charitable thing, what one would say is the Christian thing to do, and take this person in and give them food and shelter. But the other friend thinks, no way, we can't let this person in. He could be sick. He could get our family sick. And if he keeps coming, I'm going to shoot him. I don't know what the right thing is. I understand both perspectives. So I wrote the book partly to explore that dilemma and to write about both perspectives and to show what would happen if they let somebody in and show what would happen if they didn't. Many more people died, but a lot of things were similar. There was a lot of panic. There was a lot of misinformation. There was a lot of, you know, trying to blame it on different people and find scapegoats. And I think when you put a lot of pressure on a society, when you put a lot of stress on a society, all of the existing fault lines get worse. Just sort of like an earthquake, when you're pressing the society, it cracks in different ways. And I think, unfortunately, in a lot of countries, and mine is certainly one, a lot of social problems were made worse because everyone was so tense, everyone was so angry, and people tried to politicize a pandemic, and a pandemic is not political. Getting sick is not political. It crosses every border, crosses every political border, every racial border, every ethnic border, every religious border. We can all spread sickness to each other, And so I think it's unfortunate the way a lot of us reacted to it, but I think it shows that when we are under great stress, we are not our best selves. And that's one of the things I wanted to explore in the book. They're under a lot of pressure, and there's no villain in the book, there's no bad guy. No one in the book is motivated by malice or greed, but I wanted to show how even in a book where everyone believes they're doing the right thing, everyone believes very strongly that they are right and that what they're trying to do is help and make things better, you can still have a lot of conflict. You don't need a villain, you don't need a bad guy, you can still have a lot of conflict because you have lots of different people who disagree, and that causes conflict. And I thought that was an interesting thing to explore.